yesterday. And so what we have been looking at so far is the idea of right effort, the noble eightfold path, and seeing that through the eye, if you like, of the gradual training. And in reality, there is a lot of overlap between some of these factors. So obviously, right effort and moves on to right mindfulness, right meditation, if you like, which comes straight after it, one leading to the next one. So there's a lot of overlap between these factors. Not really absolutely distinct. And the same thing when we deal now with, looking at how to overcome ill will, there's a lot of overlap between overcoming ill will and developing metta. These things are very closely related to each other. And exactly where the right effort ends and right meditation begins, it's kind of slightly grey. These things have a lot of things that kind of are, they work together, so to speak. So now I want to look more at the idea of metta, how to practice that. And we already saw aspects of that yesterday, because you use the perception of metta, of the good qualities of people, to actually overcome the ill will and the anger and those problems. So one of the interesting things is when we think about metta practice, you often think about it as a meditation that you do. You sit down, you wish all beings well, you wish them happiness, and all these kind of things. What is interesting is actually much broader than that. It encompasses your entirety of action, speech, body, actions, all of these things, not just what you do in meditation practice, but also what you do outside of meditation. So that became quite clear to me when I remember in my early days as a monk, sometimes I would ask other monks who were very much more proficient in these practices than I was, and I would ask them, how do you practice metta? These were people who often had a very kind of powerful aura of them, of kindness and friendliness. And what they often would say, which I found was interesting, they wouldn't say, you sit down, you wish all beings happiness or anything like that. They said, what you do is you treat other people well, you're kind to other people. This is what they would often say. And one example, and I did this again just a few years ago, I mentioned yesterday that I went to visit this monk called Ajahn Kandaha in Thailand, who is quite, in many ways, quite close to our monastery. And when I was there, one of the kind of the tricks when you go there is to say straight away that you are Ajahn Brahma's. You're with Ajahn Brahma, you're Ajahn Brahma's disciple. Yeah? If you ever go to see Ajahn Kandaha, tell him you're Ajahn Brahma's disciple. You get special attention straight away. insider's advice on how to get special attention. Why? Because they're very close friends, and he knows. He's been to our monastery many times, he knows that, what Ajahn Brahm is like, and he always praises Ajahn Brahm very highly. He has a very, very high opinion of Ajahn Brahm, which is kind of nice, because he's such a wonderful monk himself. Yeah, he kind of reinforces things in a beautiful way. So I went there, first thing I said was, I'm Ajahn Brahm's disciple. He said, okay, in that case, we will give you lots of time. So he sat me down and he talked to me for hours after that, which was very good. So I asked him, how do you practice metta? What is your recommendation for metta practice? Obviously, he was very adept. Yeah, you could feel that. As I said yesterday, he just sits on this chair all day, and then sits on this kind of high platform, big and round, a very, very nice smile on his face. Doesn't say very much. The people are drawn like magnets to him. Yeah, they kind of like flies to the super, and come in. And they just sit there around Ajahn Kandaha. They don't really ask anything, they don't do very much. They just kind of feel the presence, feel the vibes in the air. That's enough. It's strange how that works. Yeah? If you are a person who has a lot of good personal qualities, people are just drawn to you. If you want to be popular, I'm not sure if it's good to be popular, but if you really want to be popular, metta is really the way to go. People are drawn to you in this way. So I asked him, how do you practice metta, and he said to me, very simply, he didn't say anything about sitting down, wishing all beings, may you be happy, will it be well. He said to me, when you wake up in the morning, you should ask yourself, what can I do for the world today? And it's so simple, what can I do for the world today? What can I do for the people who cross my path? What can I do for everyone? How can I enhance other people's lives? What can I put generosity in? What service can I do for everyone else? It's such a simple thing, but this is the foundation of metta practice, because when you do that, you're actually extending that kindness out into the world that forces you to see the good qualities in other people. It's very hard to be kind and friendly to someone when you see the bad qualities in them, it kind of draws your mind in and it forces you to see the positive aspects of people around you. So very simple, you know, what can I, and if you do this all the time, the trick really here is not just to wake up in the morning and ask yourself, what can I do for the world today, and then forget about it straight away. The trick is to sustain this, persevere in this moment to moment, all the time, continuously throughout the day. That is really tricky, not to forget these things. Then use your body, your bodily actions, your generosity, your speech, all the various things, all the kind of our external actions towards other people, use that continuously to be of service, to be of kindness, to ask yourself, how can you enhance the lives of others? And this is how you develop metta, and you start to feel very good about yourself after a while. Remember, this is a win-win situation. It's not you are being kind to others and you lose out. It's a win-win situation. This is the whole point of it. So very nice. And just to tell you that nice story, another story about Ajahn-Chah. There's many stories about Ajahn-Chah. I've heard a couple of Ajahn-Chah stories. Because it kind of shows you how his metta works and how it actually these things are done. Yeah, and one of the stories of Ajahn-Chah is when he came to Perth, and this is a story Ajahn Brahm tells, I wasn't there at the time, and sometimes I'm always a little bit skeptical of these stories, because they always happened a long time ago. There's a lot of time for your memory to kind of make the story bigger and more interesting. But anyway, usually, at least a kernel of truth for these stories, that's what matters. So Ajahn Brahm said, this was in the early days of Bodhidharma Monastery. And they were still doing a lot of building work. And to do building work, obviously, you need to have all the permissions from the local shire councils, all this kind of stuff. So they were all in the middle of this. They were negotiating with the shire, and they needed to have a good relationship with the local shire. So at this time, Ajahn Gandhi was staying in the monastery. And just then, the mayor of the local shire, he came to the monastery. He just happened to come. Ajahn Brahm didn't know he was coming. He came in, and before Ajahn Brahm had a chance to go up and kind of greet the mayor and wish him well into the monastery, Ajahn Gandhi had already met him. Ajahn Gandhi doesn't speak a word of English, the mayor doesn't speak a word of Thai, so there was no communication apart from gestures and that sort of thing. So Ajahn Gandhi is such a jolly person, he just went up to this mayor, smiled at him, and this mayor is this Australian man, because he was the mayor, he was wearing a nice suit and all that, but also big tummy, big kind of Australian tummy with lots of all the stuff that you kind of the beer drinking and barbecues and whatever you have to do in Australia. And so Ajahn Gandhi goes up to him and he looks at this mayor's tummy and he's very impressed with the tummy. And he takes out his hand, because there's so much kindness in other guys, he takes out his hand and he starts patting him on the tummy. This may be acceptable in Thailand, but it's definitely not acceptable in Australia, nor would it be acceptable here in the UK, right? You don't go around patting people on the tummy you never met before. But the weird thing is that if you have enough metta, you can get away with almost anything, because people feel the positive vibes, they feel the kind of the where you're coming from, and if you are from a foreign culture, you're given a little bit of extra allowance because you are from a foreign culture. So the mayor started giggling, And when Ajahn Brahm finally kind of caught up with him, they saw this kind of monk kind of patting him on the tummy, and the mayor was kind of giggling away, and he knew that now there would be no more problems in the future with getting building licenses. Everything was worked out. So this is the power of, when you come from the right place, you can get away with things that normal people can't get away with. Please don't try that, because you might get into serious trouble if you do that. This is what I have seen so many times. If you are a person of exceptional, charisma, profundity, peace, and all of these other beautiful qualities, you can say things and do things that ordinary people cannot do. Someone like Ajahn Chah or Ajahn Brahm, they can tell you off, and say something that nobody else could tell you, but it's because you know that they're coming from a good place. Because you know that they're trying to help you. You can accept their acknowledgement in a very different way than you would from someone who is coming from anger, say, or ill will. You reject this straight away because you know it's just their own personal bias very often. This is one of the stories, another nice story. When I went to Thailand, I saw this with my own eyes. And this is Ajahn Gandhi, he sits there and all the people are sitting around him, yeah? And then he has this enormous bowl of sweets next to him. Yeah, it's kind of, really, really massive, yeah? And you get these monks that come in, and they come in with kind of big containers and pour more sweets into this kind of big container all the time. And then he has a little kind of scoop, yeah? A little scoop, and he dips that into the big container, dips it in, and he sees all the people around it, and then he throws out the sweets, yeah? And it's like he's raining sweets. And the symbolism is very nice. The symbolism is that the sweet, yeah, filled with the metta of the person who's throwing it out. It's a very kind of sweet and metta kind of symbolism. And then everybody scrambles to get hold of these sweets, yeah, and kind of they take the sweets back with them. It's a reminder when you go back home, a reminder of the metta. Because it is a sweet, it kind of has a special reminder in that sense. But it's kind of weird when you see that and think, what's going on? But then once you kind of get the idea, it's actually it has a very nice symbolism to it. And then you ask him a question. Yeah, I asked him about metta meditation, but sometimes you ask him a question and he barely gives an answer. He says, for example, you ask him a question about how do you meditate? Yeah, this was a famous, this was when Ajahn Brahm went to Thailand with a large group of people from Perth, and they were said they could ask him questions, they were told. So they asked him a question, how should we meditate? And he said, this is how you meditate. Breathe in, relax. Breathe out, relax, end it. That was it, that was meditation, yeah? In Thai it goes, breathe in, sabai, breathe out, sabai. Sabai means like, be relaxed, be at ease, yeah? This is the whole meditation practice. That actually, it is actually quite profound. Because if you can really do that, if you really can relax, and really be at ease with your breath, and just allow it to be, not control, not do anything, just be mindful. It works. That's all you have to do, really. It actually is incredibly simple. All this talking is really kind of to kind of uncomplicate our complicated minds. Yeah, we're already way too complicated, isn't it? That's the problem. You just have to make it so simple. And when it's really, really simple, it works. And I'm sure you know what I mean already. Yeah, when the mind comes down, things become so simple and easy. Yeah? And that's when you know the meditation works. So anyway, this is some of these very simple things. And what is so nice sometimes about these monks or these people or the nuns or the lay, anyone who is profound and you feel a sense of profundity with these people, is if often their teachings are so simple. Yeah, so very, very easy to understand. They are not intellectuals, they don't make things complicated, they keep things very, very simple. And I think one of the reasons for that is because they know that people tend to be too complicated. The simple instructions are the ones you can remember, yeah? Just breathe in, sabai, breathe out, sabai. You can't really forget that one. So it's simple ones are what we can do, what we can remember. The complicated stuff, after a while it goes out of the window, you can't remember it anymore. So that's why now I'm going to start complicating things. So, of course, as always, I like to return to the suttas. You find the similar kind of instructions in the suttas as well. These very simple things. And this next sutta I'm going to have a look at is an example of that, an example of how metta begins, not with meditation practice, but it begins with how we treat other people in daily life. So this is this particular sutta, and I did read it out recently at the one-day retreat we had down in the Thames Buddhist Vihara. This sutta is about the monks were arguing with each other, and after the monks that argue with each other, the Buddha gives them this teaching on how to have unity and cohesion within the Sangha. Now this is what this really is about. And this is what the Buddha has to say about this. So then the Blessed One addressed the bhikkhus thus. Bhikkhus, there are these six principles of cordiality that create love and respect and conduce to cohesion, to non-dispute, to concord, and to unity. What are these six? Here, a bhikkhu maintains bodily acts of loving kindness. This is metta, both in public and in private, towards his companions in the spiritual life. This is a principle of cordiality that creates love and respect. a caduceus to cohesion, non-dispute, to harmony, and to unity. So first of all, you have bodily acts of loving kindness. Metta is the word behind loving kindness here. And the word metta, what does it actually mean? Yeah, it is usually translated as loving kindness, which is okay, it's fine, it's a perfectly acceptable translation, but what it means, it comes from the word mitta. Mitta means like being a friend, yeah, kalyana mitta. So it's derived from that. So it means like friendliness or goodwill, yeah, or you have goodwill towards somebody. In other words, you give them the benefit of the doubt, yeah, and you kind of treat them well as a consequence of that. So loving kindness is finer, but it has kind of these broader implications, if you like. Of course, when we're talking about loving kindness here, we don't mean love as in romantic love. This is this more universal kind of love, of course. So you maintain bodily acts of kindness towards others in public and in private. And that, of course, is an important principle, the idea that if you're going to practice the Buddhist path, you have to have integrity about it. It is not some kind of show-off that you do in public, and then when you go back to your room, you behave like a scallywag in your room. That's not what it is about. It is integrity. You are the same in private as you are in public. And that, of course, obviously, is very significant. This is not a public show-off. It's a thing which is integral to your lifestyle. And what is interesting here, this is this last little phrase, towards your companions in the holy life. Yeah, the Buddha doesn't say here that you have loving kindness to everyone. Yeah, he singles out your companions in the holy life. These are the brahmacharyas, the sub-brahmacharyas. And why does he do that? Why doesn't he say you have loving kindness to everybody? Why does he kind of, focus down on those people? Your fellow monastics is what he's saying here. Yeah? Well, obviously the situation requires that, because the situation was an argument between the monks, so that sort of requires it. But still, I think there is a deeper message here as well. And the deeper message is that those people who are closest to you, those people you are around all the time, that is where very often we see faults, yeah, we see problems, we get friction. Family life is kind of interesting, because in family life, on the one hand, we are attached to our family members, usually, not always, but usually, but at the same time, it's also where we have the most ferocious arguments sometimes, is in the family. It's strange, isn't it? It's kind of this duality, in a sense. And the reason for that, when you're close together, friction arises. So you love each other on the one hand, but you're attached to it. On the other hand, you also have often very bad arguments. So the point here is that if those people you are closest to, yeah, whether it's your family members, whether it is your fellow monastics are a bit like family members, yeah, because you're around them all the time, whether it is the work colleagues that you have to meet every day, if you can have metta in those situations, then you can have metta all the time, yeah, because that is the hardest thing to do. If you can deal with that, the rest is easy by comparison. So this is why I have always tried to put a lot of emphasis on having metta to my fellow companions in the monastic life. And you may think, oh, that's really easy because your fellow monastics are really good people. And there is a lot of truth to that. They are really good people. And that is what makes metta possible. But it's also the case that they are human beings. And when they are human beings, you have different ideas, different perceptions, different ways of doing things. And that always, it can very easily lead to friction. And even at the time of the Buddha, the monks would argue with each other, yeah? And the Buddha would kind of walk away because he couldn't deal with the argument. In this particular case, the monks are arguing over some very trivial matter, some very minor matter of Vinaya. This is kind of typical what happens in monastic circles. A really trivial matter ends up becoming a big argument. And then the Buddha goes to them and says, why are you arguing about this? This is a big silly. There's nothing to argue about here. And then the monks reply to the Buddha. They say to him, well, master, you don't worry about this. You just go and kind of chill and relax under the tree somewhere, and we will sort this out. This is what happens, yeah? When you argue about things, you become so sure of yourself that even the wisest kind of person in human history, you just brush them aside because we're going to organize this sort this out rather. It's terrible, isn't it? It's actually very disrespectful. But this is what happens when you group together like that and you think you're right, that you end up doing very silly things. And this happens, of course, to all of us. We're all prone to these kind of mistakes. So once you're able to see the goodness in the people around you, and in monastic life, it is not that hard. You just remember why your fellow monastics are there. You remember their underlying intention. You remember, you know, actually they have so many good qualities. Okay, we disagree about this, but so what? It's a minor little thing. And then you kind of, you keep the big picture in your mind at all times, and that enables you to befriend with your fellow monastics. Yeah, it is very unpleasant if you live in an environment where there is disharmony and there is problems. It destroys your meditation practice. One of the suttas in the Anguttara Nikaya 3, it shows you that meditation practice really only works when there's harmony. If you have disharmony in a community, disharmony in a society, then your meditation really doesn't work. Because it creates turbulence in your mind, yeah, when there's disharmony around you. When there's harmony, your mind is even, it is nice, it is kind of going along nicely. And this is one of the powerful reasons for putting a lot of effort into having harmony, at least within your closest family or the closest group around you. At the very least, have harmony there. That enables your meditation practice to flourish as a consequence. Disharmony is always going to cause massive problems. So for those of you who said that you have some problems sometimes and you find the meditation doesn't work out, well, that's the reason. Yeah, disharmony in your life, problems in your life, it tends to destroy your meditation practice. So that is then the emphasis on having harmony in life. And as I mentioned the other day, these things are very powerful when you get these things right. Harmony just to your family, how you treat your family members, how you treat your parents. That's what I discovered, how powerful it was to start treating your parents right and how they kind of come around after a while. I can't remember what I've said on this repeat anymore, so I was sometimes you forget, because I think I said the same things everywhere. Yeah, you go and wonder if you said one thing there, and after a while you forget what you said where and what you haven't said where and whatever. But in my own family, I found it extraordinarily powerful just to apply Buddhist principles with my brother, my sister, and my parents, and how it changes them. Yeah, and how they kind of start to see the power of the Dhamma to the point where they actually become Buddhist. They start out as kind of being opposed to what you're doing. Gradually, they kind of grudgingly accept what you're doing. And eventually, they turn completely around and become Buddhist. That's what happens. Yeah. And this is the power of right conduct, of metta, of all of these things, of these situations. The power of creating harmony in your family, if you like. All of this has a tremendous influence on the people around you. It's not so much what you say, it's what you do that matters. Yeah, we can say things. If we don't do it, it just becomes hopeless. So that is very, very, very nice. And, you know, it's very nice when I hear that my parents are listening to my talks online. I think, wow, this is just astonishing. Yeah. My father tells me, I listen to all your talks online. I think, I can't believe it. That's what I think. Yeah. It's not supposed to happen, yeah? Your father is not supposed to listen to you. It's always the other way around. But actually, that's what happened. And my father told me, I used to be your teacher, now you're my teacher. It's kind of unbelievable. I can't believe it. Well, I still can't really believe it, but actually it's happening. This is kind of the power of the Dhamma. The Dhamma really makes these things work somehow. Anyway, so that's just a little bit of my experience with these things. And they tend to be very, these things are very powerful. And then you have the same thing with verbal behavior. Yeah, obviously. Verbal behavior, as I mentioned before, is always a chance to give other people a gift every time you open your mouth by speaking with gentleness and kindness and bringing people together, all of these kinds of things. Verbal behavior, obviously, very important as well. Then when you have both bodily and verbal behavior of kindness and metta towards the people who are closest to you, it is very easy to have it towards everyone else afterwards. And the last one is the mental acts of loving kindness. Yeah, and this is in a large part what we were talking about yesterday, about focusing on the good qualities of other people, seeing that. And as you do that, you have natural thoughts of kindness towards others. This is obviously the hardest one. That's why you start off always with right actions and right speech, and then eventually you bring it down to your thinking mind as well. So whenever you think about someone else, you tend to think about them in a positive way. Yeah? If you have a negative thought about somebody, you see something negative, you forgive that, or you understand that people are complex or whatever. But you either have compassion or you have a sense of metta to other people. Even in your private little thoughts, when you kind of, you're by yourself, still, that's how you think about others. This is kind of the idea. And you can see here how this then almost smoothly moves into the idea of metta meditation. If you are able throughout your day to think about others in a relatively positive way, don't put the bar too high, don't expect to be perfect. Yes, occasionally we have negative thoughts, it's almost impossible to avoid that completely. But at least you're generally heading in that direction. Yeah? Then when you sit down and you try to do your meditation practice, of course it's going to be so much easier as a consequence. But also it is necessary to do that. If you haven't actually trained your mind beforehand to be positive, to have metta towards others, then when you sit down to do the meditation, it's going to be impossible to do it then. So that training really comes first. Then the meditation works afterwards. Right effort in terms of how you think about people, then comes the meditation. The same principle applies here as applies to the breath and to everything else. So this is these are the three main principles that have to do with creating harmony, yeah, which and here relate to metta. There's three more things coming up, but these are not directly related to the topic now, so I will leave this aside. And if we have extra time, maybe we can come back to these. The chances that we have extra time are virtually zero, though I have to warn you that there's always too little time on these things. So what I want to do now, I want to have a look at another sutta. And this is one of the suttas that have the most to say about metta practice in the entire Pali Canon. This is called the Simile of the Soul, the Kakkacchupama Sutta in Pali. This sutta is mostly famous for its nice similes, what happens when you develop the mind of metta. And I wanted to have a look at those similes before I speak a little bit toward the end about how to develop the metta meditation. So this is how this particular sutta goes. So just skip a few lines there because it is a bit repetitive at the beginning. And it says that when others address you, their speech may be connected with good or with harm. When others address you, their speech may be spoken with the mind of... Sorry, I think that I missed out something there. Start with the camera. When others address you, the speech may be timely or untimely. When others address you, the speech may be true or untrue. When others address you, the speech may be gentle or harsh. When others address you, the speech may be connected with good or with harm. When others address you, the speech may be spoken with a mind of loving kindness or with inner hate. Yeah, so you can see here that obviously here you have all kinds of speech. And this is one of the problems in life, is that when you, communicate with people and when we kind of deal with society at large, you can expect all kinds of speech coming your way. And a lot of the speech, not a lot, but some of the speech that comes our way is going to be hurtful. It's going to be harsh, it's going to be, it's going to be inconsiderate, it's going to be disrespectful, and all of these kinds of things. And it's hard to go by a day without hearing a little bit of this, yeah? There's always going to be somebody who says something which isn't quite right. Not because you deserve it, but simply because they have their own inner demons that they're trying to deal with, and that comes out through their mouth. The demons come out through their mouth, so to speak, yeah? So this is the problem. And one of the kind of very important things in life, we were talking about this already before, people were asking yesterday about how do you deal with pain in the body and also mental pains that we have. There are many things in the world that you cannot really change. And one of the most important things in Buddhism is to understand that certain things cannot be changed. The world is in a certain way. And this delusion that we often have, that we have a power to change the world around us, this comes from the sense of self. That's where it comes from. But the reality is that very often we actually cannot change these things. Yeah, and this is true of speech. If you go, you know, through a whole day, you meet all kinds of various people, you realize after a while, actually, you can expect sometimes to be hear things that are not nice. You can expect that. So when somebody says something to you that isn't nice, you don't think something has gone wrong. You shrug your shoulders. Okay, yeah, but that's what you'd expected. Yeah, and you don't worry too much about it because you realize this is the nature of the world. It's not nothing. It's not got nothing to do with you. It's got nothing to do with that you have done anything wrong or not. There's no reason to take these things personally. It has to do with the way the world operates. It has to do with other people's internal problems, internal turmoil, their own defilements. These things are just coming out. Yeah, so you look at them, you say, okay, yeah, whatever, and then you walk on and you continue with your own thing. You don't allow these things to touch you in a deep way to get upset in return. And this is what the Buddha is talking about here. Yeah, he's talking about this various speech, ways of speech that always come our way. Sometimes it's kind, sometimes it's not kind. Sometimes people say things for our benefit, sometimes they say things to harm us. This is the reality. Sometimes people want to harm you. Why? Well, because they are angry or because they have something going on in their life which is not nice. And you don't worry too much about that. This is what this is about. So learning that things are often not to be changed, instead of being up in arms about things, we instead we just shrug our shoulders and not worry too much about many of these things. So then, for this reason, the Buddha says, herein, bhikkhus, you should train thus. Our minds will remain unaffected, and we shall utter no bad words. We shall abide compassionate for their welfare, with a mind of loving kindness without inner hate. We shall abide pervading that person, with a mind imbued with loving kindness, and started with that person, we shall abide pervading the all-encompassing world with a mind imbued with loving kindness, abundant, exalted, immeasurable, without hostility and without ill will. That is how you should train yourself, bhikkhus. Yeah, so, and this is actually quite an interesting little thing right here. This is the standard way that metta meditation is described in the suttas, especially the last part there. But what is interesting here, yeah, first of all, you don't allow yourself to be affected by other people's silly speech, yeah, their own delusion or whatever. And then when you, because you're not allowing yourself to be affected, you start your metta meditation with that person. Isn't that kind of interesting? Because this is not how most people are taught how to practice metta. Usually we are taught to practice metta. There's different ways, but usually the standard way is you start with yourself. It's a very common way. You begin with yourself, then you go on to people you consider friendly, and then you kind of neutral people, and maybe you expand it to include everyone, even people you find difficult. But here, you start with a difficult person, yeah? The person who has just perhaps been saying bad things to you. You start with them. It's very fascinating. Why is that? And the reason is because here we are already assuming that someone is practicing really well. We're assuming that you don't really have any enemies in the world. We're assuming that your virtue is very well developed. So every time there is a problem, to ensure that that problem doesn't linger, doesn't block your meditation, you start with that person, you neutralize that first of all, and when that is neutralized and you're sure there's no problem there, then the meditation kind of takes hold again. Yeah, so the assumption here, the basic assumption is that already we have no enemies in the world. Whenever a potential enemy arises, straight away you focus metta on that person first, compassion, whatever it is, to neutralize that potential source of blockage in the meditation practice. Because the point is, and this is kind of what comes afterwards, you have metta to the all-encompassing world. In other words, there's no one who is excluded, yeah? And to ensure that this particular person does not get excluded, you start with them first of all, and then you're able to spread the metta towards everyone and have no limits. You have this unlimited metta, appamana it is called in Pali. It means without boundaries, without limits, leaving no one out. Yeah, just going on and on forever, so to speak. Yeah. So this is this is why then you have this beautiful expression here of the real loving kindness. Yeah, the all-encompassing world with a mind imbued with loving kindness, abundant. Yeah, in other words, there's a lot of it. It's not kind of developed to a small amount, developed to a large amount, exalted, because these are exalted qualities of mind. You feel exalted when you have these things, immeasurable, without limits, yeah, and of course without hostility and without ill will. So that is the idea of loving kindness here. Of course, these things feel extremely good. Yeah, it is a benefit for others, but it's certainly a massive benefit for yourself. You are the person who benefits the most from this, so it's really worthwhile. And this is why forgiveness and compassion is so important, because when we forgive, who is the main beneficiary of that forgiveness? You are the main beneficiary. Each one of us, the one who forgives, is the main beneficiary of forgiveness. That is kind of the important point. If you hold on to things, hold on to ill will, hold on to stuff, you are the one who loses most from that. So the idea that we should kind of take revenge or whatever, you are the one who loses most from taking revenge on others and thinking that they deserve ill will or whatever. This is the idea. This is interesting because it is very contrary to how these things are often taught. And one of the things that you will always notice there is that this particular paragraph does not have anything about having loving kindness to all as to yourself. Very often when you read the suttas, you have this passage there that says to all as to yourself. It is not found here. And in fact, a very interesting paper by Venerable Anali, one of my other monastic friends, he made the argument very persuasively by using a lot of cross-references to texts in the Chinese translations and everywhere else, that this whole thing about all as to oneself actually is probably a misunderstanding of the original text. Actually, probably what it means to everywhere, to an all-encompassing world. That's probably the actual meaning here. And again, that's very interesting because our meditation practice is often based on this idea. You start with yourself. That is why you have to all as to yourself. Start with yourself and then to everyone else. But actually, it is quite likely based on a misunderstanding. You can find that paper online if you're interested in it. It's a bit technical and a bit academic in nature, but it is also very interesting, I find. And actually very persuasive when you read some of these papers. Anyway, let us go on. Now we've got these really nice similes that explain what happens when you develop your mind in this way. And the Buddha says, Bhikkhus, suppose a man came with a hoe and a basket and said, I shall make this great earth to be without earth. He would dig it here and there, strew the soil here and there, spit here and there, and urinate here and there, saying, be without earth, be without earth. What do you think, Bhikkhus? Could that man make this great earth to be without earth? No, venerable sir, why is that? Because this great earth is deep and immeasurable. It is not easy to make it without earth. Eventually that man would only reap weariness and disappointment. So too, Bhikkhus, if you practice loving kindness in this way, in the same way, you are not affected by the speech of others. That's kind of what comes there in that paragraph that I have abbreviated there. So it's kind of, it's nice, because it's so absurd, this whole paragraph, that you dig a bit here, you spit a bit there, and you say, be without earth, be without earth. Because it's so absurd, that's kind of the whole point. The whole point is that if you develop a mind like that, a mind that is large, abundant, exalted, it is a mind which is like the earth. It can no longer be touched by little irritations like that. Somebody comes and kind of urinates in a corner of your mind or whatever, that's almost like what this is like. It doesn't matter, because it's just a small irritation. It doesn't affect you anymore, because your mind is so expansive, so large, so profound, so deep, it can no longer be affected by these little things. So this is kind of the whole point of these slightly absurd similes here that the Buddha is using here. So develop a mind which is like the earth, and when you do that, the earth, as it says somewhere else, the earth never complains, the earth never says anything when people do kind of pollute it or whatever. In the same way, you don't really that doesn't affect you anymore when people say and do bad things. Okay, second simile here. Because suppose a man came with crimson, turmeric, indigo, or carmine. These are all colors, by the way. And said, I actually looked these colors up to see what the difference were between them, and it wasn't entirely clear. And you look up a color like crimson, and they give you 100 different colors, all different, and they're all called crimson, apparently, so it's a bit hard to kind of pinpoint. But anyway, it's kind of a red color. And said, I shall draw pictures and make pictures appear on empty space. Yeah, what do you think, Bhikkhus? Could that man draw pictures and make pictures appear on empty space? No, venerable sir. Why is that? Because empty space is formless and invisible. I prefer invisible to non-manifested. It is not easy to draw pictures there or make pictures appear there. Eventually that man would reap only weariness and disappointment. So too, Bhikkhus, there are these five courses of speech. And you will remain unaffected by that if you develop a mind of loving kindness. Yeah, it is not easy to make pictures appear from empty space. Yeah, because it's true, isn't it? It's not particularly easy. Yeah. And again, the kind of the understatement is always quite delicious in these little things. And this is an interesting metaphor or interesting simile because the idea of empty space, yeah, is of course the idea that there's nothing that the color can hold on to. You can't draw an empty space because there's nothing there. You know, there's nothing to kind of attach to, so to speak, quite literally. And it's exactly the same thing. If you have developed loving kindness, you become largely empty inside. You empty out all the things that you normally identify with, because the normal things that you identify with, they are so coarse compared to the loving kindness. You don't identify with your nationality, what does that matter? You know, when you have loving kindness, you don't identify with your body anymore. You don't identify with the vast majority of your mental content, because it's just rubbish compared to the beauty of loving kindness. So loving kindness empties you out. It makes you peaceful. It makes you stop thinking. It makes you stop identifying with all the silliness in the world. And you become literally very empty inside. All that is left is this beautiful feeling, this beautiful well-wishing, this beautiful friendliness towards the whole world around you. That is all that is there. So this is the thing. And when you are empty inside, you become like empty space. Nothing can attach to you anymore. If somebody said something bad to you, yeah, there's nothing inside that you can kind of grasp onto. They say, you are bad. Well, who are you anyway? Well, you are just this feeling of metta. Yeah, so it kind of, there's no problem there. But if you have a sense of identity, then it is very easily to make you upset because you challenge that identity and straight away, yeah, people make you feel bad because of that. So emptiness inside means nothing for which abusive speech or bad speech can attach to or hold on to. And for that reason, it slips off, and there's no problem there anymore. The emptiness inside comes from the loving kindness. All that remains, all we hold on to, is the metta, because that is what matters, and that is what because it is so delicious, everything else is kind of irrelevant. Okay, next one. Because suppose a man came with a blazing grass torch and said, I shall heat up and burn away the river Ganges with this blazing grass torch. There are many stupid people here, that really, one after the other. What do you think, because could that man heat up and burn away the river Ganges with that blazing grass torch? No, venerable sir, why is that? Because the river Ganges is deep and immense. It is not easy to heat it up and burn it away with a blazing grass torch. Eventually that man would reap only weariness and disappointment. So too, these five courses of speech, they can't really touch you when you develop the mind in the right way. Yeah, the mind like the river Ganges, the mind is cool, just flowing on silently. It reminds me of a beautiful saying found in the Sutta Nipata, where the Buddha says something to the effect that the great sages, they are like the big rivers in the world, because the big rivers they flow silently, and whereas the ordinary people, they are like the little brooks, yeah, the little streams, Because the little streams are the ones that make all the noise. Yeah? The sage does not make any noise in the world. The sages flow through the world with silence and peace. And so this is the same thing here. You have become this big river Ganges. You flow silently, and you are so cool. And even if somebody comes with a bronze torch, of course the heat signifies the anger, yeah, or the negativity, or the trying to upset you, whatever. It can't upset you. Maybe you can kind of upset a tiny little bit corner of that river, but that's really all. And it kind of flows on. And you are like the river Ganges, flowing on silently in the world. Cool, cool mind. Cool, but at the same time, cool in the sense that you don't have desires and anger. But of course, you have the metta and the compassion at the same time. Okay, next one. Because suppose there were a catskin bag that was rubbed, well rubbed, thoroughly well rubbed, soft, silky, rid of rustling, rid of crackling, and a man that came with a stick or a potsherd and said, "There is this catskin bag that is rubbed, etc., rid of crackling. I shall make it rustle and crackle." What do you think, Bhikkhus? Could that man make it rustle and crackle with a stick or a potsherd? No, venerable sir. Why is that? Because that catskin bag, being rubbed, rid of rustling, rid of crackling, is not easy to make it rustle or crackle with a stick or a potsherd. Eventually, that man would reap only weariness and disappointment. So too, Bhikkhus, there are these five courses of speech that cannot touch you when you develop your mind with metta. So, I'm not sure if I really understand this simile, because it must be some catskin bags. We don't have catskin bags anymore. At least I have never heard of any catskin bags. So, but the idea, obviously, is that it has been, the defilements, so to speak, have been removed from that catskin bag. That's kind of the point here. So it doesn't have any flaws in it anymore. It doesn't make any noises or whatever, rustle and crackle. In the same way, if you remove the defilements of the mind through metta meditation, then you cannot really be touched anymore, because it is the defilements of the mind that are touched when other people speak to you in a bad way. But then comes the final simile, and the final simile is the most powerful one. And this is the simile after which this sutta is named. This is the simile of the soul. Because even if bandits were to sever you savagely, limb by limb, with a two-handled saw, he who gave rise to a mind of hate towards them would not be carrying out my teachings. Yeah? So that is what the Buddha is asking of you. If somebody pins you down on the ground, holds you down, takes a saw out and cuts you up, yeah, limb by limb with that saw, if you get angry, you're not practicing according to the Buddha's teachings. Yeah, so are you going to be a good disciple or not? Or what are you going to do in this kind of situation? It's pretty hard demands, isn't it? Yeah, but this is what the Buddha is saying. And people often wonder, how is this possible? Because this is obviously an incredible act of aggression, incredible act of violence to do that. Take a two-handed saw, and imagine these saws were usually quite blunt and rusty in those days, and they were going to be extraordinarily painful. So how is it possible to actually have a mind of loving kindness and compassion in this kind of situation? How is it possible to avoid getting angry? And of course, it takes a lot of training, obviously, but you can understand the basic principle, because the basic principle is exactly the same thing I was talking about before. The person who has the problem in this case is not you. Okay, you get pain, sure, but that pain only lasts a very short time. Because if someone is severing your limb from there, you're going to be dead before you die. Yeah, and the pain is gone. What's the big deal? Yeah. This is kind of... yeah, you are dead. But imagine if you live your life really well, if you have so much kindness and compassion, you don't get even angry with these people when they sever you limb by limb, savagely like this, where do you think you're going to be reborn? You're going to be so happy because you can give up this painful body anyway. Okay, it's a little bit of extra pain because it's sawing you apart, okay? So that's proper pain. You're out of here, and you get reborn, you go straight to a happy destination. You're going to thank these guys. Thank you so much for kind of making out of this. Yeah. Wow, I'm going to be so happy. This is what I mean. This is why it is possible to have metta and kindness even to people who are so so harsh and so abusive and so violent towards you. And because you realize that the person who really has a problem here is not you. They are the ones who have a problem. If you are a saint to that extent that you don't even get angry over this kind of situation, yeah, imagine the kind of karma they're making it. Yeah, imagine what's going to happen to them afterwards. Imagine how they're going to feel about themselves. Imagine where they get reborn. And when you think like that, it's what I was saying before, you turn the table. Instead of feeling, instead of being concerned about yourself and thinking about yourself and worrying about your feelings, you turn the table around and you look at them instead and you feel sorry for them. You feel you guys are so deluding. You have no idea what you're doing. This is madness what you're doing. If you understood what you were doing, you would never do this kind of things. Because you are creating, you think that you're creating happiness for yourself in one way or another, but actually you are creating enormous suffering for yourself, even though you want to be happy just like anyone else. So this is the power of this kind of thinking. Yeah. If you get it right, and this is one of the things about death in Buddhism, death is not such a big deal if you live well. Okay, you die, but if you have lived well, there's nothing really much to worry about in Buddhism. Death is just another phase that we have to go through. So don't worry so much about death. What matters is how we live. And in this case, who is the person who lives bad? Well, it's not you. It is the other people who are doing the bad things. So this way, you can turn things around. Yeah? And even though it seems very hard to do, with perseverance and commitment, you can actually get there. This is kind of the point about this. So it's a very powerful simile, but actually the point is, of course, that it does actually work. And then the Buddha says, here, bhikkhus, you should train thus. Our minds will remain unaffected. We shall utter no bad words. We shall abide compassionate for their welfare, with a mind of love and kindness, without inner hate. We shall abide pervading them with a mind imbued with loving kindness. And starting with them, we shall abide pervading the all-encompassing world with a mind with loving kindness, abundant, exalted, immeasurable, without hostility and without ill will. That is how you should train, bhikkhus. Bhikkhus, if you keep this advice on the simile of soul constantly in mind, do you see any course of speech, trivial or gross, that you could not endure? No, venerable sir. Therefore, because you should keep this advice of the simile of the soul constantly in mind, and that will lead to your benefit and a welfare and happiness for a long time. So, just lastly there, the idea of keeping it constantly in mind doesn't mean that you're thinking about this all the time, but what it means is that if you have it available in your mind to kind of bring it out whenever it is required, yeah, you have you have it like on your little shelf in your mind, shelf of perceptions that can be drawn down from the shelf, taken down from the shelf whenever it is required, so that you can use it to counteract any negative states of mind that arise at that particular time. That is what it means. It doesn't mean that you always kind of think about these things, because that is really impossible. That is what the Blessed One said. The bhikkhus were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. So those are just some similes to show you that the potential of metta practice and compassion practice and developing it as much as we possibly can. And I just want to summarize a little bit about how to do this in practice. So first of all, as I've already mentioned, you start off by developing this in daily life, you're having kind thoughts about other people. And what you're doing there is you are developing the ability to see the good qualities in other people. What is anger? What does anger arise? Remember, according to Buddhism, everything has a cause, everything has a condition. Anger doesn't come out of the blue, bam, you're angry. It comes because of certain conditions are in place. And the main condition for the arising of anger is that you see something defective, something bad, something negative, something you don't like in another person. It's called the patiga sanya in Pali. Patiga is something that is like something that, what is the right word here? Something that basically you don't like. It's basically what it comes down to. Yeah, it's something that you resist, if you like. Yeah, something which is you don't want to take on board. Yeah? So that is what gives rise to ill will. Then. So metta is the exact opposite of ill will. So it is avoiding seeing the bad qualities, but actually also focusing on the good qualities in people around you. That is the basis for the metta. And that is why when we did the metta meditation yesterday, you remember I started out by just remembering the good qualities in people, remembering the good qualities in the so many people in this world who have so many good qualities. Yeah, they're all there. Sometimes we don't see them. Ordinary people going about their ordinary lives, doing their little things, and very often having so many good qualities inside. And it's often invisible to us, but it actually exists in this world. So remind yourself of that. And then, I don't really like thinking of individuals when I do a metta meditation, and there's a couple of reasons for that. One of the reasons is that when you think about individuals, it is often we see many aspects of an individual. We see the good parts, but we also often kind of fall into seeing the negative aspects of somebody. So when you focus on an individual, it can be difficult sometimes to give rise to the metta because of that proximity between the good and the bad qualities. So instead of focusing on the individuals, go back to a kind of faceless metta. Think about another direction, yeah, or any direction. Remember that there are so many people out there, invisible beings, devas, whatever they are, who have developed these qualities to a very high extent. And you kind of project those qualities onto another direction. You imagine the beings out there. And when you do that, it's like that whole direction becomes beautiful. It becomes bright, yeah? Just like your mind becomes bright when you have a good feeling inside. And then when you see them that way, and then you wish all those beings well, through that intention, that sometimes, if you get it right, the good feelings arrive as a consequence of that. But again, there isn't any absolutely right way of doing this. Sometimes the way that works for you may be different from what works for somebody else. So you do what you feel works for you. And if you prefer to do it towards individuals, if you want to start with yourself, if you want to do whatever, do what works. Yeah, this is kind of the most important thing. Yeah? So this is what this is about. And then when you then project that goodwill, etc., out towards the various directions, then the idea is to give rise to this feeling. Yeah? And the point of this is not to kind of keep on saying a phrase again and again and again and hoping that that's going to make it work. The point of this is just to say it very simply. Keep it very simple. May all the beings there be happy. May they be well. And then just wait in silence. Stay with the perception of beauty. Stay with the perception of good qualities. And when you stay in that perception, then often the feeling will arise as a consequence. These things are not easy to do. Please don't feel like a failure if you can't do it, because a lot of people find it difficult. For some people, it happens quite easily. So if you're one of those, then that's wonderful. If not, don't feel like a failure. Keep on doing it until one day you make the breakthrough, and suddenly these things start to work as a consequence. So those are some very simple instructions of how to do the metta meditation, just like the breath. It should be very simple. It should be something very something you don't put in much effort, something that you allow to happen almost automatically, without effort, just by bringing up the right perception in your mind, and then it goes almost by itself. Okay, that is all for this morning, and in 15 minutes we're going to have the last interview sessions or whatever, so if you are on the list and you want to come over, you're more than welcome to come over to that interview room behind the reception area at the other end of the building. We'll see you there in 15 minutes.